I would like to call onto stage Mr. Aslam Khan, who is a software technocrat by profession, entrepreneur by passion, and a philanthropist by heart, having experience in technology, strategy, management, and entrepreneurship. He now serves as CEO of Octaware Technologies Limited and has been its managing director. He has worked for many top MNCs like Microsoft, Citibank, NA, AskMe.com, TCS. He has also established a charitable trust and a hospital as his contribution towards the society. He is also a board member of NASSCOM, the premier IT association in India. Now, I would like to ask a question. How many of you have traveled in the world, and how many countries? Anyone traveling 10 countries in the world? 10. Any more 10s? I'm also one of them. Okay. Anyone more than 10? Okay, good. So, Mr. Aslam Khan, and you, anyone knows how many countries in this world? Total number of countries? How many? Any other guesses? No, it's 195 countries in the world. And Mr. Aslam Khan has traveled 100 of them. So, a big hand of applause to Mr. Aslam Khan, whom I would like to call on to stage to present his success story.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Sadaqallahu al-Azim. Sabse pehle to main mazrat chahunga. For the last 3 days, I've been having a bad sore throat. Yesterday, I was in Delhi for my other startup. There was a investor pitch to the private equity, and there were 8 different pitches. So along with the bad sore throat, coughing, and then India's topmost venture capitalist and the private equity firms, it was not easy. So I damaged my throat further. So dekhte hain how long I can continue. So let me begin with the educational background. I completed my engineering from this town, Sabushdi College of Engineering, and today I'm proud to see the director of our institute, Ms. D'Souza, is here with us. So 1996 was the time when I passed out from the engineering college, Sabushdi College of Engineering. 96 was the time when it was a boom for the IT industry, as we all know. So it was a wave of the information technology industry where I got the opportunity to work for Citibank in Tokyo. So on a very first job, landing from India to Tokyo at the age of 22, got the opportunity to work in Citibank building the securities trading platform. Now, the way basically I have planned to share my stories with you is not to just narrate their story, but as we know, we have some students here. So with the incidents and the experience which I have got, I would like to reflect upon certain learnings, certain key takeaways from those incidents and from those experience which I had. When I was in Citibank in 1996, and today, if you were here in the panel discussion of finance, Mr. Srinivas Kunte, he was my first boss in Tokyo, Japan. We all together were building a trading platform for the operation of the shares of corporate world. Without knowing much about Sharia compliance of a job, And whether working in a banking industry is allowed or not, at least till we were doing our engineering, we never thought about the Sharia compliance of our job. So when I was there, I spent 2 years in Tokyo. So initially it was a hard work, just going to the office, building the software. Over the weekend, when you are away from your family and friends, you try to build a social network. And that's where I started going and finding out the mosque. Though it took 6 months to find out the mosque in Tokyo, because that time the Google was not there in 96. So the only search engine which was available, I don't know if you're aware, it was Alta Vista. That was the search engine which was available during that time. And they did not have a data of finding out the mosque, and we were not senior enough to go back to our embassy and find out where the mosques are. So anyway, when I started visiting mosques, that time it was the interaction with the religious people. And all of a sudden, when I started visiting the mosque, I started hearing that working in a bank, working for a bank, city bank, is haram, is forbidden for a Muslim. And how can you, the name Muhammad Aslam Khan, how can you work for a bank? This was my first encounter with the people who were talking about certain things which are forbidden as a job. There was, I did not know about it. So I worked there for 2 years, but then that kind of a thought, when you started discussing with the people and everybody talking about working in a bank, I mean, you get nervous, isn't it? At least that triggered the thought process that, is it working in a bank is haram, the Citibank? As I said, there was no Google, there was no your family or friend whom you can talk to. So anyway, I started finding the new job that let me switch the job from either from Citibank or even from Japan, either I'll go back to India or I'll go back somewhere else. And in 98 time frame, I got the offer from Microsoft in US Seattle, and that's where I moved from Japan to Seattle to work for Microsoft. Let me take a pause here and let us reflect together the learning which I had during this period of 2 years, a dilemma or the confusion between, while you are passionately working, because you got the break of working in Citibank. I mean, not everybody gets a job as a fresher to work for multinational, and that too in Japan. On the other hand, you are surrounded by the philosophy of what is forbidden and what is permissible. That's a dilemma. That's a confusion. And I'm sure at the age of 22, 23, that is not easy. So here, if you just reflect upon this incident and the experience, what we could understand and learn, that in our life, when at least when you are beginning, it's not easy, and you will come across this kind of a dilemma. You will be in confusion. And when the information is not available, when the right information is not available, it becomes more difficult. If you don't have a guide, if you don't have a coach, if you don't have a mentor to give you the right direction, sometimes you land up in a wrong decision. Though for me, it worked, fortunately, that I got the offer from the Microsoft in US, but then that confusion was a lot. And I was the only Muslim in working in Citibank, so at least I could not talk to my colleagues whether working here is permissible or not, right? So the learning for me here is like, you know, that, and when we talk to the colleges, the students, we always say, look, at that age, when you pass out from the institute, you will have this dilemma, you will have this. This is just one example. There will be a lot of incidents where you will have this confusion. Most of the time when the students are in the, let's say their graduation, and now they want to go for the next option of their career, whether they should go for the job or they should go for the higher studies. Again, that's a dilemma, that's a confusion, right? And at that time, it's you who have to take a right decision with the help of the right coach and the right mentor. The second learning which I can conclude in this, during this experience, was that though people might not know that whether it is permissible or not, see, if you look at it, when I shared with you the beginning of my journey with Citibank, what we were doing was building a software a product for trading the security or the shares, which is not near to the interest. The reason I think why the scholars in the Islam, they talk about the working in the banking domain is prohibited, maybe because of the interest component, the riba component. But then we don't have an expert, unfortunately, the community who can go and deep dive and try to understand whether when we say bank, is it the only interest or there are more to the banks. So it's not just the only interest, but there are more than that. So securities trading was allowed. Later on, when I moved to US, I was told that working in a trading sector or in the building the software is totally permissible. But anyhow, the people, even though they don't have knowledge, but if they really have a concern about you, about your hereafter, the important lesson here is to listen to them. They are your mentor, they are your well-wisher. Though they don't have knowledge, they might not guide you properly based on what you expect or what you think right, but listening to your elders, listening to the people who are your well-wishers, and seeking their guidance is always helpful at that age or at any age. So that's one key learning which I can say during that time. Now from there I moved to US working for Microsoft, and that time in 1998 Microsoft was preparing to launch the Windows operating system 2000. I was fortunate enough to get the opportunity to work hardcore in developing the Windows operating system 2000 version. From there, 98, later on, as we know, in 2000 timeframe, it was a dot-com boom, where most of the companies, they lost their employees. Even in Microsoft, 30% of their strength, they quit the job. From 100,000 people strength company, they joined the 10 people startups. Because that time, the startup was the boom, the investment community was investing the money like anything to the startups. I moved from Microsoft to a startup company, Ask Me, where I was leading the engineering work in that particular startup. Now from there, from that startup, we were outsourcing the work to India, because as we know, India is a big outsourcing industry, and especially it's a services industry. We don't build the products, we don't build anything out of it, though for the last 3-4 years, we have started hearing about Make in India, Startup India. So that time we were outsourcing the work to India, and the thing which I realized, and I found out, that typically when the US customer base, when they outsource the work to India, it is majorly because of the cheaper cost. The labor here is cheaper, we get the developers and the software engineers in abundance, and hence the cost is low. So because of the cost effectiveness, the work is outsourced to India. We don't find the architects and the designers, right? For example, if you look at a building, an apartment, yes, we need the laborers, we need the engineers, but the beauty and the architecture of the building is all depends on the architects, how beautifully he's architecting. India was lacking in the IT industry architects. And that was the idea and a thought which started emerging in the mind, that how about if we go back to India and start a company where instead of just providing the services on the engineering side on a cost-effective manner, in other words, just instead of providing the labor, cheap labor, why don't we basically create a boutique firm which offers the architecture services? With that thought, I moved back to India in the late 2005 after spending 8 years and surrendering the green card back to the offices. Now that's again a learning lessons here, and if you reflect upon it, when we start a business, when you think about a business, typically today most of the time when we think about starting a business, it's because of the survival issue. We think about that, oh, we are not able to do anything, so let's start a business. Or somebody in my family, one of my neighbor, one of my friend has started this company, so let me also start a company. We don't find a reason to build a company. We don't find a purpose to build a company. Or in fact, the concept of purpose is totally missing even in our life. Today, even if you ask this question with our students, why are you doing your MBA? Now, I don't know if you have a meaningful answer. Typically, there is a theory behind it. There is a philosopher and a thinker, Simon Sinek, who developed a theory of three golden circle rule, which really is a favorite theory for me. And he talks about that there are three different circles. There is a component of the outer circle is a what, the inner circle is a how, and the innermost circle is why. And he says most of the people, they know what they are doing. What you want to do, you want to do your MBA. Yes, you know that you want to do your MBA. And how do you do your MBA? Yes, you know you have to give your exam, your competition exam, you have the CAT, you take the admission to college, complete 2 years of your curriculum. But then why are you doing your MBA? That bit, which is the innermost circle, is missing. The answer to the why always gives the purpose to whatever we do. But that's the important thing which is missing. Now, coming back to this, the point which I was making, that when you start or when you plan to start a business, always, if you have certain ideas, if you have certain plans to address the pain areas, you identify the pain, you identify something different which you can solve, not the traditional what the others are doing. Typically, we just jump on what the others are doing. Somebody has started a company, he is doing well, he has become a millionaire, I'll also become a millionaire. We don't have the answer to why. Why am I doing it? What is the purpose of starting my business? Now, the business when we started, that time the idea was very clear. We don't want to be among the crowd. We don't want to create the next job, MNC, and labeled ourselves as one of the body shopper or the manpower supplying company, though this manpower or the bodies are the literate and the educated engineers. Our goal was very clear that we want to do something different. Unless you do something different or you do the things differently, you can't survive. And that was our strategy to establish the company where we provide the architecture services to the companies back in US. So that was the key message which I wanted to share with our businessmen and our future businessmen who are the students and planning to start the business. You have the idea, try to solve the problem, try to do things differently, come up with the different things. Now, the one bit which I wanted to share here, coming back to our own land after spending 10 years starting a company, surrendering the green card, it has two different reasons. Otherwise, it's very difficult. I mean, if you look at the rate of people coming back from the US, surrendering their green card, leaving their citizenship, is 0.01%. Out of the 1,000%, 1% comes back to India. Of course, there was a personal reason, but behind it, the main purpose was to establish a company, to establish a business which not only just creates the profitability, but also creates an example for the fellow businessman. From the day one, our philosophy was very simple, to follow the Sharia rule, and we wanted to be different. And entrepreneurship was always on top of our mind, because I was the firm believer in the entrepreneurship. With entrepreneurship, it's not only you help in developing or in creating the economic development of the country, but you also contribute in the social development of your nation. Now, if you have these two objectives, the two purposes of your plan, you basically establish the company with that purpose. We started this company, alhamdulillah, with the blessing of the Almighty. Today, our company is present in 8 different countries, and we keep on evolving. It's not just we started with architecture services, and we continued with architecture services. We kept on differentiating our strategies. Always, we were striving to do something different than others. 10 years journey from 2005 late 2006, 3 years back when we basically took over the space in SEEBS by the government of India, where we started saving the corporate taxes, we decided to take the next leap and the growth and plan to go for the listing as Ajay Thakur sir was mentioning, with the help of the consultants and the team, in 2 years' time, we were able to list the company to Bombay Stock Exchange, and we became the first ever fully Sharia compliant company listed at Bombay Stock Exchange. Thank you. Definitely, this journey of success was not just my journey alone. As I mentioned, when I moved back to India, there was a time there were people who were moving back from the different countries. I have my colleagues here who moved from Qatar, colleagues moved from US, from Germany. We joined the hands together to establish this company. The philosophy was very simple. As it is said, if you want to walk fast, walk alone. If you want to walk far, walk together. So that was the philosophy behind building a team of intellectuals to build this company. And today, alhamdulillah, the journey which we started together 11 years back, today we are still growing from one country now to the 8 different countries. So the last bit which I want to explain about the vision of the company, it's very important to set up the vision when you build a corporate business. Our vision was very simple. It was to serve, add value, and create growth for the individuals, businesses, and the entities. We are the strong believer in not only just the growth of our individuals, but also to the society. We strongly believe in corporate social responsibility. Now, alhamdulillah, for the last 10 years, we have done a couple of CSR activities, which was remarkable, and it added the value as a part of the fulfillment of our vision of the company. One of such initiatives was to create the employment for the blind in the IT industry. 4 years back, I was approached by a philanthropist who was running a center for the blind in Delhi, Manesar. Her strategy was to look for the blind or the visually impaired in India who could speak English. And she used to bring them to Delhi and keep them and train them to generate the employment for them. The kind of employment she was generating for them was to basically do some kind of a back office work or writing something or building the envelope, getting the stipend of around 4,000, 3,000 rupees a month. She approached me in one of the networking event for the donation. And during the pitch, she started talking about those blinds and the visually impaired guy, that they not only speak English, but they can also operate computers. And that time, my thought was that since we are the strong believer in the CSR, why don't we join hands together? And that organization was the National Association of Blind Employment and Training, NABET. Now, I gave her the idea, so why don't we collaborate together and work on a program to create the employment for these blinds in the IT industry, because the IT industry, as far as I know, is the highest paying industry. Now, that time, it was a very amazing comment. And she said, Aslam, jab kisi ko chanda dena nahi hota hai, to ideas dete hain. Ideas are free, ideas are simple to give. So, chuki aapko chanda donation nahi dena hai, to theek hai, ideas are good, yeah. And we just left the event. I came back to Mumbai and again persuaded her. I sent her an email that, look, I'm not kidding. I'm not just, I'm serious about what I proposed to you. And let us work together. And again, she ignored. So after third email, typically, as we know in the business, when you do a sales, you have to have this quality of the perseverance. You have to keep following up to your client, to your customers. Here, she was our client for the social work, because that's what the part of our vision, to do something good for the society. We persuaded her, and finally, she landed up in Mumbai. She understood the plan. And we came up with a program where we built up the entire curriculum for the blind for the testing in the software. So that was the plan which we came up with. So we spent some time in building the curriculum, but we did not have the idea of how to train the blind people. We did not know how to communicate with them. So we onboarded a special trainer who had the experience of training the blinds. They came down to Mumbai. We trained them first. So it was a train the trainer program. Then they went back after this training. We spent around 3 to 4 months to train those blinds, around 15 blind people. We started the pilot program with them. After the 4 months or 6 months of the training, we started the hands-on practice for them. We gave our own product, because Octaware along with the services have built the intellectual property products. So we offered them to practice whatever they have learned on our product for 6 months. After 1 year of the entire exercise, their resumes was built, and we started marketing their resume in the industry. We approached Microsoft, we approached local companies, TCS, Adobe, and finally, after a year of an effort, Adobe outsourced the work for 7 people for 85,000 rupees a month per resource, out of which 45,000 rupees was handed over to the blind per month, and 40,000 rupees was taken by the organization itself. So the organization, which was running around to raise the donation, was now a self-sustainable organization, making around 7 into 40,000 rupees a month, around 2.8 lakhs rupees a month as an income. And the blind who were making around 3,000, 4,000 rupees a month, started making 45,000 rupees a month. So that's kind of a impact which we have created with our social CSR activity. So we don't believe in just directly helping by offering the CSR fund, but working closely with these organizations to create the bigger impact in the society. That's our firm belief, that's a part of our vision statement, and we live by our vision. With this, I would like to conclude. I think I have given up with this was my capacity and my limit of my throat. So I would like to stop here. Maybe after during this tea break, if you want to understand a little more about the other activities which we are doing to create the social values with our business, a sustainable business along with the highly growth social impact, I would be happy to share more on it. Thank you very much, Sakita.